Here we have a very simple dual bed DI system, also called a twin bed system. At Puretec, we refer to this as a CS setup, and we identify the top necks with red for the cation and yellow for the anion. The cation always goes first before the anion tank, and you'll understand why in a bit. So the cation tank with the red tape has cation resin inside of it. To be more specific, the resin is strong acid cation resin. These resin beads are small plastic beads that have microscopic ion exchange sites within the bead. Each of these exchange sites with the cation resin has a fixed negative charge. So during your generation, we saturate this resin with hydrochloric acid. And hydrochloric acid is made up of hydrogen, which has a positive charge, and chloride, which has a negative charge. Because the cation resin beads have fixed negative charges inside the beads, they will attract the positively charged hydrogen ions, and the hydrogen ion will attach to all of the exchange sites within each cation resin bead. The chloride, on the other hand, has a negative charge, and since the same charge repels each other, the chloride will not attach to the cation resin bead and will go to drain. So that is why we call this type of resin strong acid cation resin in the hydrogen form. For example, if you were to saturate this type of resin, which strong acid cation resin, if you were to saturate it with sodium chloride, then the sodium would attach to the cation resin bead since it has a positive charge, and you would refer to the resin as strong acid cation resin in the sodium form. And we actually do that for softening tanks. We also call those sodium C tanks. Those are the tanks with the black tape around the top that are used to produce soft water. Okay, now for the anion tank. In a dual bed or twin bed DI system, you will have a cation tank followed by either an S tank with yellow tape, which is strong base anion resin, or a W tank with green tape, which is a weak base anion resin. Let's start with the strong base anion resin first. Just like the cation resin has fixed negative charges inside the bead, the anion resin has fixed positive charges within the resin bead. So during your generation, we saturate the strong base anion resin with sodium hydroxide. The sodium has a positive charge, and it will not attach to the anion resin bead since they are both the same type of charge. However, the hydroxide ion has a negative charge and will therefore attach to the exchange sites within the anion resin bead that have a positive charge. So after regeneration, we have strong base anion resin in the hydroxide form. So now we're ready to make deionized water. But first, let's review a few basic facts. City water contains a large amount of dissolved mineral ions that our customers need to have removed to prevent scaling and other issues. This is also referred to as dissolved solids, dissolved salts, dissolved metals, or just TDS for total dissolved solids. It's all the same thing. Basically, these are a bunch of ions in the water, and an ion is an atom or molecule that has either a positive charge or a negative charge. So a positively charged ion is called a cation, and a negatively charged ion is called an anion. For example, some common cations found in water are calcium and magnesium, and some common anions found in the water are chlorides and silica. Okay, so let's take a look at what happens when you run city water through a dual bed CS system. As the water enters the cation tank, all of the positively charged ions in the city water, the cations, will attach themselves to the cation resin bead, and the resin bead will release the hydrogen ion that was placed on the bead during regeneration. This ion exchange process happens all throughout the resin bed, and eventually the water leaving the cation tank has had all of its cations exchanged for hydrogen, and the negatively charged anions have been unchanged. They pass right through the tank. What this creates is an assortment of strong and weak acids, such as hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, silicic acid, and so forth. That is why it's extremely important to place the cation in the lead position, or else you will produce acidic water that can damage the customer equipment. The conductivity of the water leaving the cation tank will be much higher than the feed water entering the tank due to the presence of these acids. Once this acidic water goes inside the anion tank, all of the hydrogen in the water will remain unchanged because it has a positive charge. But all of the negatively charged ions in the water, the anions, such as bicarbonate, chlorides, silica, and others, will be attracted to the anion resin bead, and it will have to kick off the hydroxide ion that was on the anion resin bead. So now, all that's left is hydrogen and hydroxide, which combine to form H2O, or pure water. And that is how deionization works. However, with a dual bed system like this, it has its shortcomings due to sodium leakage. What happens here is that the sodium ions in city water have a very weak charge, and occasionally the sodium ion will not kick off a hydrogen ion on the cation resin bead, and it will simply pass on through to the anion tank. Then the sodium ion meets up with the hydroxide ion and forms sodium hydroxide, or caustic soda, which is a conductive and increases the conductivity value. This is also why a CS dual bed setup has a slightly higher than normal pH, since caustic soda is basic or higher on the pH scale. A CS set will produce deionized water, but never to the high level required in many applications. You'll also see dual bed systems that have a C followed by a W. The W stands for weak base anion and is identified with green tape around the neck. Weak base anion resin will not remove any weak acids that were generated from the cation tank, so you will experience lower than average pH levels with a CW set. The W tank also does not remove silica or CO2, so your conductivity values will be even higher than a CS set would produce. Now, in order to produce high quality deionized water, someone finally had the idea to mix both strong acid cation and strong base anion resin together in the same tank, and we call that a mix bed. And we place brown tape around the neck of the tank. You will also see polisher tanks, which are also mixed beds, with blue tape around the top. And it's the same thing, it's the same principle. However, polishers are handled and processed much differently than a mixed bed with brown tape around the top. In a mixed bed, the sodium leakage is not such a problem, since the cation and anion exchange process happens thousands upon thousands of times over and over throughout the resin bed. A mixed bed really performs best after a dual bed CS setup, since the CS, the cation anion, does the heavy lifting and removes a large chunk of the dissolved solids in the water, and then the mixed bed can remove the final remaining dissolved solids and will produce a very high quality deionized water supply with a neutral pH and very low conductivity or high resistivity, depending on how you're measuring it. Finally, let's look at activated carbon. Activated carbon does not perform ion exchange inside the tank, but rather it serves two purposes. One is that it removes chlorine and chloramines from the feed water. That is why activated carbon is oftentimes used before a DI system or an RO system. This is because chlorine and chloramines are oxidizers that can damage resin beads and also aural membranes. Activated carbon also removes organics, which can cause issues with both ion exchange resins and reverse osmosis membranes. We identify activated carbon tanks with the letters GAC, which stand for granular activated carbon. Thank you for listening to this. If you have any more ideas on informative videos, please let us know and we'll make them. Thank you.